The roots of the Democratic Party, which had sprung from the ashes of the Democratic Republican Party in 1830, were deeply and unquestionably racist. I know this is quite a statement to make, but Democrats repeatedly lied to, broke treaties with, and slaughtered Indians. They supported slavery, fractured the nation with secession of the South, and in large measure were responsible for thrusting America into the Civil War, which cost over 600,000 lives. The political ideology of the Democrats, however, hadn't been so radical or so destructive as their racist tendencies, at least not until Woodrow Wilson. Wilson coupled the party's racism with radical progressivism. That's why the election of 1912 was a critical turning point in the history of the party and the United States. While it was a former Republican, Teddy Roosevelt, who started and ran under the Progressive Party banner, it was Democrat Woodrow Wilson who was even more progressive than Roosevelt. A note here, progressivism is Marxism that is accomplished without revolution, more slowly, and under a different name. The principles are essentially the same. It was under Wilson's leadership that the Democratic Party took a huge left turn. It had been a party that had been leery of centralized government. While Wilson pushed for and succeeded in greatly enlarging the size of the federal government, the one they were also afraid of, he also adopted the policy of an early Democratic progressive, William Jennings Bryan, in pushing for, and this time succeeding, in bringing about a progressive national income tax. Seems we always forget the progressive part of tax. Now, up until his presidency, the United States had been free of the burden of a permanent national income tax. It was almost universally believed to be unconstitutional. Yet, Wilson took office March 4th of 1913, and by October of that year, the United States had been fundamentally transformed and altered with a new progressive income tax. With it came the IRS and the Federal Reserve, and America would never be the same again. Wilson had also changed the American power structure. Before his administration, the executive branch was, at best, simply equal to Congress. But he made the presidency superior to Congress. Wilson also worked really hard to fundamentally transform the United States. Of America's original founding document, Wilson said,
"Some citizens of this country have never got beyond the Declaration of Independence. The Declaration of Independence did not mention the questions of our day. It is of no consequence to us."
Americans were never meant to get beyond the Declaration of Independence. It is inextricably linked to the Constitution and to every principle of governance that we hold dear. It is the idea of America, while the Constitution is the framework to make that idea work. Wilson's thoughts, however, on the Constitution were similar to his thoughts on the Declaration.
"All the progressives ask or desire is permission. In an era when development, evolution, is the scientific word to interpret the Constitution according to the Darwinian principle, all they ask is recognition of the fact that a nation is a living thing and not a machine."
In other words, all he desired was the ability to interpret the Constitution in whatever way he might deem appropriate. In Woodrow Wilson's mind, the Constitution was ever-changing, ever-evolving, rather than a set of rights that were eternal. With that in mind, Wilson set out his agenda. One of his worst acts was sponsoring the Espionage and Sedition Acts. The Sedition Act prohibited criticism of the government, armed forces, or the war effort. This, after Wilson had promised and been re-elected for keeping the United States out of World War I. If the citizens dare violate the act and actually said, "Wait a minute, what did you just say?" they were imprisoned or fined. Some 1,500 people were arrested under this law, including socialist presidential candidate Eugene Debs. As if all of that weren't enough un-American activity for one president, Wilson went so far as to have thousands of German Americans forced into one of two internment camps that he had set up in the United States. One of the camps was in Utah and the other one was in Georgia. Remember, this isn't the Japanese internment. This was two decades before. Just a few of the notable German interns were geneticist Richard Goldschmidt, as well as 29 of the very scary and dangerous members of the Boston Symphony Orchestra. The orchestra's musical conductor, Karl Mack, spent more than a year at the camp in Georgia, as did Ernst Kunwald, the musical director of the Cincinnati Symphony Orchestra. What are we afraid of? Oh, are they ninjas with the batons? How, you might be asking? In a nation with a revered constitution such as America, which prohibits all of these actions, can all of this take place?